Well, please turn in the Word of God to the book of Exodus in chapter 6, and let me read you again verses 1 to 8. Now the Lord said to Moses, "Now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh, for with a strong hand he will let them go, and with a strong hand he will drive them out of his land." And God spoke to Moses and said to him, "I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but by my name, Lord, I was not known to them. I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, in which they were strangers. And I have also heard the groanings of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians kept in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. And I will bring you into the land which I swore to give Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a heritage. I am the Lord." Well, last week we considered the prayer that Moses made when the Israelites approached him, having had counsel with Pharaoh. And Pharaoh had told them that their request to have an easier time, as they had once before, before he added extra burdens upon them, was declined. And that the problem really was with Moses, who had drawn them into a false words as he made the official line. Well, Moses turned to God in prayer, and he poured out his heart. We saw it was a very human prayer, and though it may have had many faults within it, yet of course we have one who is on high, who makes our prayers perfect and sanctifies our prayer. And that's a wonderful thing to know. And we can should pray with confidence that we will be heard. Well, Moses was heard. And the verses that we have before us this morning are God's gracious and comforting response to Moses, and with words to speak to the Israelites. From the very start, we read in verse 1, he says, "Now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh." So God starts from the very beginning what he will do. Now, this is very instructive to us, because sometimes in great difficulties, we, as being human as we are, tend to focus on the problem itself. And some people worry about the problem, the difficulty. They turn it over in their mind, their hearts become very anxious, and they do not know where to turn. And so the danger there is focusing on the problem. So the world comes with its wisdom and counsel, and it says, do not focus on the problem, focus on the solution. And that sounds good advice, doesn't it, from the surface of things? But what it's really saying, what world is saying, is, look, there is a problem, don't worry about it, get on, sort it out, use every resource available to you, and tackle the problem head on. Well, that sounds very positive thinking, doesn't it? To tackle the problem that you have. So don't focus on the problem, focus on the solution. However, what the Bible says is very different from the world. It doesn't say focus on the problem. It says acknowledge the problem before God, but focus on God. Focus on what God is able to do. And so when we face difficulties, we're not to look down, we're not to look around, we're to look up. And that's some very basic instruction that the Christian learns from a very early start. We look upwards and we pour out our hearts to Him and we say, Lord, You are God. You are sovereign. You are all-powerful. You are able to deal with this problem that is beyond me. And it causes me much anxiety and trouble. We've got a very strong opponent in Pharaoh. He has great power. He has an army. He's worshipped as a god. His word stands as law. He has given his decree that the words that you have said are false. We're under great difficulty. So bring it to God. Tell him about it. And ask him to come and deal with the problem. That's what God says. He says, I am the Lord. I am the Lord. This is what I will do to Pharaoh. For with a strong hand, he will let them go. So this is God from the very start. It's not Pharaoh who's in control. And that is the narrative that Pharaoh wants all the Israelites to know. That I have decreed that you will not go. I will not heed to this God of the Israelites. And in fact, what Moses says are all false words. And I'm going to show you I'm in control by making things so much harder for you. And so he seeks to put down any hope that they may have had in the words that Moses first brought to them at the end of chapter 4. Well, we need to focus on the Lord. We need to have assurance that He knows all about the problems that we face. He knows about it, and what's more, He cares for us personally. Now, isn't that a wonderful thing that the Almighty God, the God who made the heavens and the earth, the God who sustains the universe, cares for you and the worries in your heart? And if there are any anxious thoughts, we're to bring them to God and He will give us peace, because He knows about us, He knows the circumstances, He knows the primary cause, He knows where it's coming from, the devil, He knows when it's part of this fallen world, He knows all the troubles that we have, and He cares for us. And He will perform for us all that He has promised. And we can take comfort in that, that He is our God and our Heavenly Father. And so we would say with the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans, he says, what shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Pharaoh may stand opposed to the command of God to let the people go, but Pharaoh will bow to God, and Pharaoh will let you go. The will of God and the purpose and decree of God is stronger than the stoutest will against Him. If God be for us, who can be against us? It doesn't matter if all the hosts of hell and the devil himself and all his fallen angels would set their face against us, God is for us. And nothing, as Paul goes on in Romans 8, can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Well, God says here, doesn't He, in Exodus, that He will bring them. He will make sure that Pharaoh himself will obey him and drive those people out with a strong hand. And he says, you shall see. Now, here, look at the verse very carefully. Now you shall see what I will do. Now you will see. God isn't offering them a further extension to the promise that he has made because of the difficulties. He's promised to do something. He's promised to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob that the land of Canaan would be given to their descendants and that he would be their God and this would be their land that he has promised them. He said that it would be 400 years hence that they were to go and become, live in a foreign land, the land of Egypt, and that they would be even enslaved to those Egyptians. But he says, I will bring them out and bring them through and bring them into this land, and I promise it. And so there's the great promise. There's the great hope that is set before us. God has said something and he has given a time scale for it. He says, trust in me and you shall see it. And it won't be another 400 years. It will be in your lifetime. It will be in the recent weeks ahead. And there's going to be a great contest, and God is going to display his power, as we will see in what he says in these coming words. Now, this is a great encouragement to us. We must be certain that God is in control and he is powerful and he is able to answer according to his perfect will. God has a timetable. And like the trains that run in Switzerland, they've got a great reputation for never being a minute late. Not like British Rail, or I don't know what it's called these days, but, you know, we often get delays. Maybe some leaves have fallen on the line or something, I don't know. The Swiss train timetable is something that you can be, that they pride themselves in keeping on time. Well, God has a timetable, and he will keep to that timetable. He's not going to delay it because of unforeseen circumstances. Pharaoh decided in the pride of his heart that he would not let the people go. God will keep to his timetable. And that God was going to actually, his timing was perfect. And that's a great thing, isn't it? When God hears our prayers and answers our prayers, he brings us relief and deliverance from those circumstances. Those circumstances might be the testing of our faith. Well, it's important that you don't short circuit the work of the trial to purify our faith. So God tailor makes the trials and the difficulties that we go through, that it may have an effect, and at the perfect time, he will bring relief. So God's answer to you might not be immediate, but that's because of his timetable. And we can't ask God to sort of hurry up. You know, we can't do that with God. We have to be patient and wait upon the Lord, and he will bring us that help and relief at the time, in his perfect timing. So it's important for us to know. I think there's much for us to learn here. So he's not going to divert his will. He doesn't have to change his decree according to the unforeseen circumstances, because God has decreed all that will happen. And his answer will be at the right time, and it will be to the right measure, and we will know it, and we will thank him for it. So that's a great thing for us to learn, isn't it, from this passage. So before they were to leave, now this is one of God's purposes, before they were to leave Egypt, they were to witness God's power. God is introducing himself, you could say, to the Israelites. They need to know that the God that they worship isn't some local deity, but he is the Almighty God, and there is no other. He is absolute in his power. All these gods, so-called, of the Egyptians, they were polytheistic, they had many gods. Every one of them would have to bow down to God, that he is the Almighty and the One. And they were going to witness the punishment of Egypt and their idolatry and the great cruelty that Pharaoh kept them under. Egypt was to be punished. They were ripe for judgment, you might say. And God was going to punish them. God was going to bring them out with a mighty hand, with great drama, with hailstones so large that it would decimate the land. And many of these plagues that were to be, they were to see, they would witness and say, this isn't just a natural occurrence, this is the hand of God. And when they come out, and certainly as they come through the Red Sea, they would be able to tell their children. This is going to be the book of Exodus and the punishment of Egypt and the display of God's power and glory were to be the words that their children and their children's children will be hearing for the rest of their days, as long as generations occur. In fact, we are the great heirs of this great covenant of grace, and this is our history. This is our God that we are worshipping. And it's good for us that we've got the book of Exodus. It would be much lower in its impact and its display of God's glory if Pharaoh was to say, well, you've put up a reasonable argument, Moses. I will let the people go. I will obey God. And off you go. And they were to go and perhaps even find a way around the Red Sea. They weren't pressed by an army, and it became necessary for them to cross through the middle of the sea. They could have taken a long way around, found some kind of bridge or built something lower down the land and crossed over and found their way into the Promised Land. But of course, that would have been a very poor history in comparison to the drama and the excitement and the adventure, if I can put it that way, that God enabled his people to go through and brought much glory to himself. And so this is something they will tell their children, what God did. Not the great statue put up for Moses, the great deliverer, the one who came back and said to Pharaoh and won the day with his great political arguments and his debating skills. No, it's a power of God. God did it. God has the glory. And you can be sure, even when they were settled in Canaan, that those that of the godly remnant would be speaking of the Exodus and to generation to generation. So this is a message. God was bringing about historical events that would form the message that he is able to save to the next generation and the generation after that. So, as I say, it includes among all those generations our own generation. This isn't the history of the Jews. This is our history. It's our God. We worship the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob, the God of Moses, the God of David, the God of Elijah, the God of Isaiah, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is our God, and this is our history. And we would do well in seeing the power of God displayed, which is a faithful historical record, and worship God accordingly. So, Let's come back to our problems. Now, of course, when we see the greatness of our God, how small our problems really are. Well, if God is able to deliver a whole nation from slavery and bring them through the Red Sea and provide for them for those 40 years in the wilderness and bring them into the Promised Land, is he not able to do such for us? Well, of course. What are our problems? If God be for us, who can be against us? What confidence we can have. So we face our problems and we're not scraping around some worldly thinking of how we can solve our problems. We're going to God and he's going to answer our prayers. And we will see and be witness and bear testimony to the goodness of God in bringing us through difficult times. So consider your problem. This is what we've been saying. Consider your problems in the light of God's power for you. And that is how we are to view things in a right way, by faith. Consider your problems, great though they may be, but look at them in the light of God's power. Now you see, we are up against difficulties. Pharaoh, his great purpose, and we see how wily he was, that he wanted to eradicate all hope. He wanted to crush any beginnings of faith in God among the Israelites. And there they are. They've been told by Moses. Moses is going to appear to Pharaoh. They will soon be free. There's a little bit of anticipation. There's a hope that's rising up within them. And then it gets crushed down. And they find themselves working harder and being whipped more for their inability to fulfill the quota of bricks. So that was Pharaoh. He wanted to eradicate. This is exactly what the devil wants to do. He does not want hope living in your heart. He wants to fill you with anxious thoughts and worries. He wants you to become someone who can't sleep because you are overly worried about your problems and you're seeking, trying to find an answer. That's exactly where he wants you. He doesn't want you looking up. He doesn't want you trusting in God. He doesn't want you to have a living testimony. This is what God has done for me. And so Pharaoh, he wants to eradicate all hope. And you see it in verse 9. Because we're told in verse 9 that Moses spoke thus to the children of Israel, but they did not heed Moses because of anguish of spirit and cruel bondage. It seems that Pharaoh is winning the day. But he's not going to, is he? But that's where he wants us. He wants them in a state of anguish. He has sown into the mind that Moses, into their mind, he wanted to convince them that Moses was a false prophet offering them false hope. That's what the world tries to convince us of. He says, why are you going to church? Oh, you poor person. You know, you need some Christianity, some kind of crutch to get through life. You can't face your problems. You go to church, you trust in this invisible God. And you see, they mock. They want to convince you that there is no God. There is no hope. Give up. And life's become, since you've become a Christian, has it got better? Well, no, you would say it's got worse. It's become more difficult than it was before. Well, you need to give it up. You need to stay away and look at the world and get some worldly counsel. Maybe you ought to go to some professional psychologist that will be able to help you and get some therapy instead, right? Don't turn to prayer, right? Turn to a therapist. See what they can help you. See what advice they will give you. And maybe go to the bank manager and there's the debt. You can sort it out. You can make an arrangement for repayments. You can have all that worry lifted off of you. You just need the right kind of guidance and help. No, you see, that's where the devil wants us to go. But we want to go to the throne of grace, and we want to go and remind ourselves that there is a God who reigns, and there is a Saviour who is seated upon that throne of grace, who is our sympathetic high priest, who knows us and loves us, and he knows what we're going through, and he will pray for us. That's the direction that we should go. So do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, with prayer and thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. So let's be real here. Circumstances that they were facing were crushing. And if you are going through difficulties, we are not seeking to minimize the difficulty and say that it's not real and just ignore it. Christianity isn't put your head in the sand, and the counsel that you get from a believer isn't don't worry, it'll probably be all right in the end. It will work out. You know, that's the counsel that the world gives, doesn't it? You're going through a difficulty, someone puts an arm around you. Don't worry. Don't worry. Be happy. It'll all be right in the end. And what kind of counsel is that? Worthless counsel. That's what it is. You know, we're not putting our head in the sand. We're not saying it'll be all right. We're saying God is in control. God is my God, and he hears and answers prayer, and I will turn to him. So, you know, take their arm off you and say, thank you for your concern, but I've got one who cares about me more than you. Well, I'm not suggesting you do that, but the point being, you don't need the counsel of this world. You need what God is able to provide, the grace that he is able to provide for you, the love, the peace. In there, you see, don't you, Paul and Silas in the Philippian jail. And they've come to Europe. They had this vision from the man from Macedonia, come over and help us. And what have they faced? Persecution, and they've been publicly maligned in the market square, and great stripes put upon their backs, feet fastened in the stock. They're not going to get out of there, it seems. They're not going to face an honest trial and be released and sent on their way. They're going to be there. And that was going to be the end of Christianity. So they thought, in Europe. No spread under this stronghold of the devil. But no, God is able. You see, they're not licking their sores and complaining about their treatment. It's midnight and they're praising God. And they're praying for their persecutors. And they're worshipping and rejoicing. There's joy in their hearts because they believe that God is sovereign. And they can face the trial. And of course, God brings an earthquake. And there's a little church that is established. The first one in Europe at Philippi. We're going to hear a little bit about Philippians tonight, God willing. And there it is, the beginning of the church. Wonderful. God is still able. So there it is. We turn to God. We don't put our head in the sand. On the contrary, we evaluate the problem. We look at it with great detail. We don't ignore it. We don't push it to one side and put a number of papers on top of it and things like that and try to, no, we face up to it. We bring it to God. We lay it all out before him. Say, Lord, I need help. And he will answer us. Ask God to help you. Ask God to intervene when it seems impossible. When those Israelites came to the Red Sea and the armies of Pharaoh were coming up behind them, it seemed an impossible situation. The people panicked. Moses had to quieten them down. God said, tell the people to be quiet. Be still and see what God is able to do. And at that, the Red Sea opened up and a great fire wall separated them from the enemy. And God brought them through, every one of them. That's what God's able to do. God is able to intervene. He's able to do the impossible. That's the God whom we worship. So there it is, verse 1. God says, Now you will see, you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh. And then in verse 2, it says, and God spoke to Moses and said to him, I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but my name, Lord, and the original there would be Yahweh, sometimes translated Jehovah, the Lord, my name, Yahweh, I will be known to them. It's wonderful. He's the personal God. He's the powerful God. We see that in verse 1. Here in verse 2, the personal God. It's one thing to know that God is Almighty. It says that in verse 3, doesn't it? He is the Almighty. It's one thing to know that. And some people speak of God Almighty, the God who is in heaven. They don't know him personally, but their conscience tells them that there is a God, and the creation around them tells them that there is a God, and they know him by reputation, by his handiwork, that there is a God, but that's all they know him as, the Almighty God. And you might have friends, and they're not born again of the Spirit, but they would speak respectfully of the God that we worship, and they would talk to him about, and they would use the name God. That's how they know him. But we have the Lord. We have Yahweh. We are in a covenant relationship with God. So he's not some God who is in heaven, far away, that we can perhaps pray to and hope that he will hear us while we're in the trenches. He's the God whom we know, the God who we have a personal relationship with, the God who we are in. He binds himself to us by way of a covenant and promises to care for us. And it's the same thing that a husband would do when he marries his beloved, and he promises before God and before all the people that he would care for his wife and he would love her through better for worse. And he would love her as Christ loved the church. And she says, I will obey my husband. Okay, if you no obedience, it's not a Christian marriage. Right? She takes that position of deference toward her husband and she says, for better for worse, I'll be faithful to my husband. Now God makes a promise to us. He says, I will be faithful to you. I will care for you. I won't let you down. He is the covenant God. He's bound to us. God is bound to us via a promise that he has made. And there was no one greater than himself to swear an oath. And so by his own name, he swore that he would be our God. And he would be bound to us. So he did appear to Abraham. We see that here. I am the God. I appeared, it says in verse 2, to Abraham. It reminds us that here is the man who was the great example of faith. Now, Israelites, see your forefathers. See the difficulties he went through. See the extenuating circumstances. See how it was that God said in the testing of his faith, now take your son Isaac and offer him to me. And he obeyed. And God intervened. And God provided a lamb instead. This is the God. The man of faith, a man who believed God. He looked up and took hold of the promises. He said he was an old man and his wife was far beyond the age of childbearing. And God says, look up at the stars, see if you can count them. He says, so will your descendants be. And Abraham believed God. And Abraham believed that God would one day send a Saviour. And by trusting in that Saviour, Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. As he believed on the one who God had promised to send. The one who would be born from the descendant of Abraham, and Isaac, not Ishmael, but Isaac, and not Esau, but Jacob, and not Reuben, but Judah. And you see, the house of David, all the promises coming about, and eventually the Lord Jesus Christ comes. Abraham believed in him. He trusted him, and it was enough. It was enough. He saw it by faith, far off. What wondrous faith. God-given faith, as it is with any of us who are saved. Well, Abraham was that great example of faith, wasn't he? And then he provided for Isaac a wife. Not Leah, but Rebecca and Leah, it seems, as well. But, you know, God provided for him, didn't he? And he kept him. And then, of course, he met with Jacob and wrestled with him. The angel of the Lord, it's the person of Christ in pre-incarnate form, wrestling with Jacob. And Jacob, who said, there he is, he's under great difficulties, his brother is coming out against him. And he's wrestling with this angel. And he says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Here is prayer. This is prayer. This is the spirit that you must have. I am the God of Jacob. Yet all these people did not know my name, as I have revealed myself to you, Moses. When Moses said, who shall I say has sent me? He says to Moses and he says to the Israelites, my name is Yahweh. I am who I am. The God, Yahweh. The God, sometimes we know him as Jehovah. We know him. There's a difference. I'm sure you can appreciate this. There is a difference about knowing about a person. You no doubt this very day know about our Queen, Queen Elizabeth II. And you can think of her in Sandringham today. And there she is. 70 years upon the throne. She's been seen. I read in the paper, I think it was yesterday, that the Queen has been seen by as many as 30 million people. That's a great number. And a great number have met her. Hundreds of thousands. I've never met the Queen. I met her husband at one time, back in 1976. And you had some words with him. And I'll tell you the story another time. But I've never met the Queen. I know about her, right? But I don't know her. I can't just knock on her door at Sandringham and says, hey, it's me, it's Andrew. You know, I've come to visit you. I wouldn't get past security, right? I'm not saying that I wouldn't be seen. Probably would. It's just a long way to go. The point being is I know about the Queen, but I don't know her personally. And it's so wonderful when you see these little insights and you see the human being behind the crown, and you get to know a little bit. Possibly we do know a little bit. But you see, this is God. We know about him. People know about God. But it's another thing to know him personally. To know God personally and to be known by him. If I was to write to the Queen, if I was to write to the Prime Minister, or anything like that, and say, it's Andrew. You know, I might get a response. I did write to the Prime Minister once. I did get a response from him, but it was from his private secretary. Thank you for writing. I think it was a standard kind of copy and paste kind of answer. But the point is, we can know God. We can know the God of heaven and know him as our Heavenly Father. That's a wonderful thing, isn't it? To know him as our Heavenly Father. It's one thing to know God Almighty, the Creator. And it's another thing to know him as the Lord, our Redeemer and our Saviour. Many today, God is somewhere. There are very few atheists. Atheists are self-deluded people. Did you know that? An atheist has so deluded themselves to say that there is no God. And I find it quite amusing that they shake their fist at the God that they don't believe in, supposedly. But most people are agnostic. We believe there's a God, but can you know him? Is he really there? Is he there somewhere? Perhaps he is. I'm not sure. And if you were in the trenches, you would be a man of prayer and you would be praying to God. But he's someone out there, someone we don't know. Our conscience tells us that one day we must give an account of our lives to God and we will stand in the judgment. And sometimes for many people it is a matter of fear, because they're aware of some of their sin and of their blasphemies of their lives and how they haven't lived a life that is worthy. But they're going to have to give an account. And this is why there is a fear in death. You don't fear nothing. If what the atheists tell you, that like Bertrand Russell, when I die I rot, well, there's nothing to fear there. No wonder Dawkins says stop worrying. It probably isn't the God, so stop worrying about it. Just live life to the full. But we know, don't we? We know that there's a God to whom we must give an account. That's how we know about God. But it's another thing to feel the love of God in your heart. That's the believer. That's the Christian. That's the born-again believer. The love of God, here's the experience, and we're not exaggerating or embellishing anything. We say we know of how God has filled our hearts with love for him. And sometimes it's been overwhelming. And sometimes you feel, maybe not to the extent that Jonathan Edwards said, and he said, stay your hand. It was too much for him to bear. The glory of God. We've known something of it. We know the love of God. It says in Romans 5, the love of God has been poured out into our hearts. And we've got a joy which we cannot hide. He cannot explain it. The joy that we feel as we worship God, as we think about the work and saving work of Christ for us. Sometimes it's at a Lord's table and we're so overwhelmed with gratitude to God. We know him. We feel his love. This is the assurance. This is the pinnacle of the Christian experience. I am known by God and loved by him, and I know it. He loved me and gave himself for me. That's wonderful, isn't it? I am the Lord, he says. And I have established my covenant with them and given them the land of Canaan. And I've heard the groans of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians kept. So here again, we got the verse 4. Confirmation. I have established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage in which they were strangers. He's talking about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. They didn't inherit the land themselves. They didn't see it under their possession and their descendants. They looked by faith. They looked to a better country, we're told. But Canaan is the promise. And these Israelites were going to know it. I'm going to give it to them. That's what he goes on to say, doesn't he? Therefore, he says, I will, verse 8, I will bring you into the land which I swore to give Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a heritage. There it is. That's what God is going to do. So we have far more. They were going to have far more than Abraham possessed. He bought a grave for himself and his wife. And that was it. That's all he had. But these people were going to live in the land. God was going to drive out the Canaanites. And he was going to establish, and they're going to have the olive groves, and they're going to have grapes, and they're going to have this fertile farmland. It's going to be theirs, a land flowing with milk and honey. They're going to live in it. Verse 5, he has heard their groaning. I have heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians kept in bondage. Isn't it? It's good to know that God hears and sees. You know, that's one of the complaints. Why has God just abandoned us? Does he not see how we're being treated? Does he not see the hardship? Does he not see the anger and hatred in the heart of these Egyptians as they kept us under bondage? The thought that came into the Israelites, does he really know? It's just sometimes you find it in the Psalms. We're under great difficulty. Does God really know? Job, does God really know? But here is the thing. God tells them in verse 5, it says, I have heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians kept in bondage. It's the Egyptians, it was Pharaoh, not God, that was bringing these things. That's good to know. And they blamed God, didn't they? At the end of chapter 5. They're blaming God. They're saying, look, via Moses, you know, when you have a go at leadership, you're really having a go at God who's appointed that leadership. Yeah. Pointing at God. Well, God's going to answer them. I've got 5 minutes to go through 7 points. Have we got time? I'll go through them very quickly. Maybe we'll have to spend next time. Let me just give you some of the headings. Because God gives an answer to them. He doesn't just reprove them for their unbelief. He assures them of a number of things. Number one, we'll go through them quickly. Number one, he is the covenant-keeping God. There it is. We see it here, don't we? I am, therefore say to the children of Israel, verse 6, I am the Lord. There it is. I am the covenant-keeping God. And the invitation was given to them to know him and worship him. That's the first thing. No false god could claim what he was about to do for them. That's the first thing. Number two, he delivers from their burdens. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. He delivers us from our burdens. Just like the Lord Jesus Christ, who said, come unto me, you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's the God to whom we worship. This world will be a great burden to us, but God is able to help us. We feel weighed down. Perhaps this morning you'll feel weighed down with all the troubles. God knows about them. He will remove those burdens. Come unto me, Jesus said, and I will give you rest. Number three, it says he will rescue them. I will rescue you from the bondage. Right? If they wanted to escape, if they wanted just to leave their job and walk out, they couldn't do it. And the gospel message is exactly the same, isn't it? Makes the same point. It says we are enslaved to our sins. It's no good saying, now come on, pull yourself together and turn from your sin. You need God's help. You need him to break the chains. And one of the great aspects of being of salvation is being saved from the power of sin, as well as the penalty of sin. To hold you back is a power that holds people. The gospel says he's able to break the chains and deliver us from the bondage. Number four, he's going to redeem them. And I will redeem you, he says, with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. He will redeem them. He will make the payment. The price of slavery, he's going to pay the price with blood. The blood of the lamb on the Passover night. This is seen in the Passover lamb, isn't it? He makes payment. To whom is the payment due? There's a good theological point for anyone to chew over during lunchtime. Who's the payment due? Wasn't to Pharaoh. Not to Satan. He actually acted unlawfully in enslaving those people, but to his own absolute justice, he pays the price. A crime has been committed. Here's the question, are we undeservedly slaves to sin? Is that what you say to the congregation as they gather at the gospel service? You don't say it. You say you deserve. You are enslaved to sin. He who sins, Jesus said, is a slave to sin. And so we're accountable to God. And a payment must be made. Justice must be served. But any payment is paid, of course, by God's grace to God's justice. Number five, judgment. With an outstretched hand and with great judgments. Judgments due on Pharaoh. That's what he gets. Not the payment price, but the judgment. He was the one who enslaved them. He was the one who added cruelty. So God will therefore punish him because he deserves it. There's a series of plagues. And what are the plagues? They're a series of judgments on Pharaoh and Egypt. It's going to ruin the economy. He's going to decimate the army. And because of the reign of Pharaoh, it's going to be taken down. Pharaoh himself is going to be a great loss. He's going to lose his own firstborn son, who he'd been grooming to take over from him as the next Pharaoh. Going to lose him. Number six, I will take you as my people and be your God. God will adopt Israel as his own, and he's going to richly bless them. And that's what he does. He saves us from sin and its power, but he also brings us and adopts us into his own family. And seventhly, he promises them a future. He says, I will take you as my people. I will be your God. Then you'll know that I am the Lord who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will bring you into the land and give it to you as a heritage. And there it is. He promises them a future into the very land that he has promised. All of these things he's done for us. It's a great gospel message. 7 points. But finally, he does this for his own name's sake. As he goes on at the end, I am the Lord. What a wonderful message. What a wonderful message. How would the Israelites receive this message that God gives to them? Well, you can read it in verse 9. But the big question is, how will you receive this message? Could be there's someone here who will be hearing all these things that God is prepared to do for you in the person of his son, in saving you from sin and bringing you into his family and bringing you at last into heaven, but you won't believe it. And if you don't believe it, you won't receive it. God makes these promises to you in the gospel. I counsel you from the word of God, receive by faith the things here presented. May God help us to do so for his sake. Amen.